Good morning. Can I have a question?
Go ahead.
Okay. Do you know how to get credits for this lecture? Is there an exam?
I can't hear you. Can you repeat kindly? I mean, there's
sure.
So lots of static on the line. So.
Oh, sorry. Is there an exam after the lecture, or? I don't know, it's based on the, what are the terms to get the credits for this lecture?
You will get the credits.
Okay. Thank you.
we are slowly coming to, I mean, the semester ends at the beginning of February, so we are slowly coming to an end, and this is not the lecture. You were there, so don't worry anyway. Okay, I mean, the rules of what I have to sign change from a semester to semester. I mean, last time I had to physically sign it. The previous one, I just sent a little piece of electronic paper on which I wrote the names. I mean, the only problem is that I was continuously asking you for a list of participants, and I copied the certain names, but there is one person which appears on the screen with the letter BK, and it is not Barbara Klepka, for she is also appearing under the full name, so I have no focus idea.
Okay, so explanation.
So I mean, if somebody wants to be on, I mean, I can't write that the individual BK was there, right?
That was me. Sorry.
If you were really there and you want to get the credits, you have to help me with the names. All right.
Okay, so BK, good. It was me.
No, you were. I mean, you were in the full name.
But the BK was me, because I needed the screen and I needed the microphone, so I had to be on two devices.
Oh, all right. Yeah. So I can erase the BK right now.
Yeah.
I understand.
Okay.
I mean, I assume that there is something funny with this, but
sorry.
Well. Let's hope the microphones will be working. All right. So good morning. And let me try to share the screen. This is the most dangerous moment of the lecture. Good. And we finished last week talking about the Thomas Mann and his comments about the differences between the symmetries in inorganic, as it was said in the previous century, world and organic world. And I show you that the symmetry that the, I mean, an example that the symmetries of the living structures all over the world are essentially different than the symmetries of the crystals, for example, and as an example of that was the snowflakes. But that allowed me to jump to another interesting point of science and literature. And I finished with showing you what looks like a monster. But that's the phase diagram of water. And remarkable, in a school, it is always shown that little piece of the phase diagram next to the solid liquid vapor. And what is important is that this is the phase diagram for the water at the, which is a pressure versus temperature. So it's a constant volume part of it. And it leads to many confusions. For example, there are these famous points which are labeled red here, like a freezing point on one atmosphere and a boiling point on one atmosphere. And this is this Kabbalistic 0 degrees Celsius and 100 degrees Celsius. And you have to understand that this is a phase diagram, and these lines are coexistence lines between different phases of the matter. That does not imply, and unfortunately this is what is taught in the schools, that the water freezes at at 0 Celsius at 1 atmosphere, and it boils at the 1 atmosphere. That's incorrect, because these are the points at which the vapor coexists with the liquid water, and liquid water coexists with the ice. But as you see from this diagram, there are lots of different phases of the ice. There are lots of them, and you have even a 15, I believe it's now slightly more. And there's also something new, which is not on my diagram. I was a little bit lazy and didn't correct it by showing that there is a little bit controversial, but a new liquid phase of a water at the very high temperature, at very high pressure. And the existence of it was first discovered by computer simulation by Gene Stanley and Frank Stillinger. And it is not observed experimentally so far, but most probably is there. We tend to believe in the computer simulation nowadays even more than on the real experiment. So as you see, there are lots of solid phases, and they correspond to a different crystallographic structure of an ice. The water is a complicated substance. It is a simple molecule, 2 hydrogen atoms and the oxygen atom, but the quantum mechanics tell us that this is not linear molecule, and that 2 hydrogens are, so to say, on the one side of the oxygen, and the angle between the hydrogens bonding in the molecule is this Kabbalistic 105, something degrees. And this is the angle which comes out from the quantum mechanical calculations. And that is the angle which makes the water what it is. I mean, if it was slightly different, for example, if the Planck constants will be a little bit different value than this one which exists in our universe, then the water will have completely different properties, and the biological life as we know it would not exist. So this angle between the hydrogen in the water molecule is the angle of life. And but that also means that the charge in the hydrogen is not actually uniformly distributed, and the water has a dipole moment, and electric dipole moment. And that is the fantastic property of water, which makes it so good solvent. And this also means that there are possibilities of different crystallographic phases. I mean, the oxygen sits in a certain lattice points, but the question, what is the lattice, depends on how these hydrogen atoms are arranged with respect to the oxygen sitting on the one and the neighboring lattice side. So we have this enormous amount of lattice. There is a whole branch of statistical theoretical mechanics, which is called the ice physics, and there are lots of ice models. Some of these ice models are exactly solvable in the same sense as the easing model is exactly solvable, and there is lots of very interesting physics of these different phases of ice. But today we are focus our attention on that little phase, which is here shown with the blue arrow, and this is labeled ice 9. It truly exists, and its equilibrium properties, as you see, are here. It exists at the very high pressure, more than 100 megapascals, and it exists at the very low temperature, slightly below 100 degrees of Celsius. So if we pressurize ice at the very low temperature, then we can get this very narrow area on the pressure temperature region where there is something which is called number 9. But why do I mention this particular phase? Because it play a role in the literature. And there was, unfortunately, a very important American writer, Kurt Vonnegut. And Kurt Vonnegut was born in 1922. And when the United States was attacked by Japan and decided to join this worldwide war, which was at the time in all over the world, as its name suggests, he was sent for a military training before being sent to Europe, and then the military training was at the Carnegie Institute of Technology, which is now called Carnegie Mellon University in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and he got a lot of engineering and scientific training for, he was supposed to be in those units of military service which will require this additional knowledge of the science. And he was sent to Europe, and that was already at almost the end of the war, but he was in those American units fighting the bloody battle which goes under the name of a Battle of Bulge. This is a battle which was the last big battle on the Western Front, where the German army attacked the American army in the Ardennes Mountains on the Belgium territory. And Kurt Vonnegut was taken a prisoner. As a prisoner of war, he was sent to the kind of a camp for the prisoners of war, which was also the labor camp next to Dresden in Germany. And he had been there, and he had survived this incredible bomb attack on Dresden, when the whole city was essentially destroyed by the what was called the mass bombing and the firebombing ordered by the British Air Marshal Bomber Harris. And that was an incredible disaster. There were more people killed than after the bombing of Hiroshima with the atomic bomb. I mean, that was really a terrible bombing effect. And he survived it and wrote the book later on, wrote a book about it. I will tell you a few words about it later on. But his scientific training allowed him to write the book, which is called The Cat's Cradle. The book was written in 1963. This was the time where there was a political friction between Soviet Union and the free world reached the apex. And you might have heard about the Cuban Missile Crisis and so forth and so forth. And the a problem of the danger of existence of our civilization caused by the existence of atomic weapons was felt by the most of the population, and the lots of people were truly worried about what will be the, what is the future of our civilization. And many important authors, like Kurt Vonnegut, who already was pretty well known at the time for his previous booklets and his articles published in the serious newspapers and so forth, they had their own way of warning us about what might happen if we will not control a dangerous sides of the research, like, for example, nuclear research. So the Cat's Cradle is a story about an American journalist who is interested, gets interested in what had happened to the American physicist of a German origin, a certain Honecker, a gentleman with the name Honecker, who is a Nobel Prize winner in physics and was one of the people of the team which built up the atomic bomb. So he was a member of Manhattan Project. Sure, this is completely fictitious person, but I will tell why he was of a German origin slightly later on when we will be talking about the movies by Stanley Kubrick. So this journalist tries to find out what had happened to that scientist who had all of a sudden disappeared from the public life. And he finds his family living in a nice resort place in the United States. And turns out that the Mr. Honecker is deceased. He's no longer with us. And the family of particularly two sons of this Mr. Honecker, those two sons play an important role in the book, they are in the possession of the discovery of Mr. Honecker, because in his work on atomic weapons, he discovered that there is a ninth phase of the ice. That's why I have shown you this phase diagram. And that ninth phase of the ice is at equilibrium at the room temperature at the normal pressure. But it has a peculiar property that when it touches any little amount of water, it freezes this water and turns it into the ice nine. So it had to be kept well separated from environment, because when it is in a contact with environment, then there will be a disaster, because water is everywhere in our surrounding. So the all water in the world will get frozen and become the ice nine. And the amount of that little amount of the Ice-9, which was manufactured by Mr. Honecker, is in a possession of one of his sons, I believe Frank. And the Frank is living in a little fictitious republic in the Caribbean, which is called San Lorenzo. That is, unfortunately, our Minister of Foreign Affairs, who had one of the ministers of Foreign Affairs of Poland, who invented the Caribbean Republic, San Escobar, didn't know about the Kurt Vonnegut book. He could have used the San Lorenzo name. Anyway, the San Lorenzo is a dictatorship, and it is tremendously poor country. So that was written at the time when the Republic of Haiti was run by a dictator, Duvalier. So in a certain sense, the San Lorenzo is a little picture of Haiti. And Frank Honecker is a bodyguard of the dictator. And to cut the long story short, this dictator committed suicide because he's very ill, and committed suicide by eating a piece of that ice nine. So he got frozen, and it's put up in a special container, so his body is not touching any water. And there is a revolution on an island. There is also an earthquake and tremendous situation. And in that situation, that sarcophag in which the body of a dictator is stored is destroyed, and this cadaver falls into the ocean, and the ocean freezes, and there is a worldwide disaster. All the water is frozen. This is the end of the civilization as we know it. Who survived it? A couple of people, including the journalist, in a bunker which was built by the dictator and was so well shielded that this ice nine could not penetrate that bunker. And after many months, they get out of that bunker, and this is this description. So Kurt Vonnegut warns us that we should be very careful with controlling a possibility of a negative use of the scientific discovery. And that was the book Cat's Cradle. What is Cat's Cradle? And a Cat's Cradle, as you see, this is one of these string games. I don't know whether you have ever played it. It's you take a piece of rope, which is closed loop, and you put it on your fingers, and there's a question, how without cutting the rope to construct different space structure of ropes, as is shown here. This was a popular children game in Europe, and it turns out that this kind of a string games is pan-cultural, because the Alexander Wallace, this British biologist, who is in some sense a co-author of the Darwinism theory. He was even a co-author of one of the papers with Charles Darwin. He, when he went to the Indonesia on, I believe it's on Java Island, where the Dayak are living, it was one of the subcultures there. He found out that the Dayaks also knew that kind of a game, and there was never ever any connection between those two civilizations before Wallace went there. So and one of these string games is called the Cat's Cradle. So that was the reason why, that is supposed to be this cage in which the civilization finds itself. as I said, the Kurt Vonnegut was a prisoner of war in Dresden during the bombing. And in 1969, he wrote a book about this, what is happening. It's called The Slaughterhouse Five, for he survived the bombing, being part prisoner, but escaping from prison, but hiding himself in the slaughterhouse, one of the slaughterhouses in Dresden. And this is the description. By the way, the Dresden was bombed in a very intelligent way, so to say, for the the historical downtown with this tremendous castle Zwinger, and which is one of the biggest collection of art in Europe. Grüne Gewölbe, the famous treasury called Grüner Gewölbe, which is there. Somehow it was saved. I mean, it wasn't damaged. Similarly as during the bombing of Cologne, the cathedral of Cologne wasn't bombed. And the other side of the Elbe River in Dresden, which is called the Weißes Hirsch, then it wasn't also bombed, because the bombing was operated by the American pilot who was parachute next to Dresden before the bombing, and he get to the Weißes Hirsch, and he was directing the bombing from the ground, so to say. So that part of the city was saved. This is a tremendously interesting book, and The Cat's Cradle is more fun to read than The Slaughterhouse Five, that's for sure. All right. And so as you see, we somehow see from that, as we proceed through our lectures, that the period of time of the 20s and 30s was the period where the art was very much interested with the dystopian view of what happens to our civilization. That was in the Fritz Lang movie like Metropolis, and we had this incredible movie. We talk about it. And slowly in the 30s, the civilization was changing dramatically. The consequences of the First World War have been felt. And we had this explosion of a science development. The quantum mechanics was born, and the first application of a new discovery in physics have been implemented in the everyday life. We had this tremendous telecommunication revolution. We have the essentially complete coverage of the area of the United States by the telephone lines, also in Europe. And we have the radio, which becomes everywhere, ever present. Even in the Poland, which regained the independence after the First War, already in the 1920s, the national radio was established, and that had a tremendous influence on how the civilization was developing. The Polish national radio, which in spite of the name was actually a private company, it had the obligatory duty of having, having a special programs for farmers. And in many villages, the local heads of village were obliged to have a subsidized radio receiver. The radio receivers were expensive initially at this. And at that hour when this special program for farmers was broadcast, they were supposed to put that radio set in the window, and the farmers from the village were encouraged to gather around that house or that garden and listen to the special programs, which were disseminating knowledge about the modern farming, so to say. So the radio was playing an incredible role, but also the economical crises were one after another. And it led to the tremendous political change in various countries in Europe, particularly and in the other countries in South America, for example, as well. The political motions or directions of which are are associated with the word of fascism have been fascist movements had become popular. They were strongly nationalistic movements, and we had one in Italy, which was the Italian black shirts motion under the leadership of Benito Mussolini. And the peak of it was the Nazi government in Germany, which won the election completely democratic in the 30s and destroyed democracy and brought this disaster of a Second World War on the rest of the globe. And one of these pre-Second World War episodes of the initial tremors before the explosion were felt all over the world. They were felt in the Far East. There were lots of wars, little wars going on in the not so well developed at the time countries, like, for example, what is called today Myanmar, if I'm correct, which was used to be called the Burma. And it also got the civil war in Europe, which was a war in Spain. We were talking a little bit about that by discussing the art of Picasso, where I have been showing you this famous painting of Picasso, the Guernica. And that was a picture of a village dedicated to the memory of the village Guernica bombed by the German flying division Condor, which was participating in the civil war in Spain on the side of the General Franco. So I would like to, I'm mentioning because that is related to the name of one of the remarkable writers of the 20th century, George Orwell. Orwell was a British author and who started his life as a police officer in the Burma. And one of his first books is The Burmese Days, a book about his experience from the time he was in Burma. But there are two pre-war, so to say, books by George Orwell, which are also shown here. The one is the homage to Catalonia. Catalonia is that province of Spain where the Barcelona is located, and it strives for its independence. And it was an area where this bloody civil war was extremely cruel. And Orwell was a war correspondent there. And he wrote that book. There were lots of people observing or participating in that war for the legal government of Spain, which was attacked by the General Franco, had the support of many intellectuals all over the world. And one of them was Ernest Hemingway and his incredible book, To Whom the Bell Tolls, is about precisely the same if historical events, the civil war in Spain. And the one of the most important books by George Orwell is called The Animal Farm, which was published just before the war. And that's a book about the fascism. This Animal Farm is the description of a growth of the fascist movement, which is put up in the form of a farm, which is run by the pigs. But George Orwell was then the war correspondent during the Second War, and in the 48 and 49, he had written a book which was a prophetic book. It's called it has a very simple title, 1984. And this is clearly a book written under the influence of that the world in the 40s was completely frightened. And this fear exists until today of what can happen when the totalitarian governments will get a possession of the nuclear weapons. And in 1984 is a dystopian story about the, in some sense, a civilization of the metropolis, that completely technocratic society we described by the Fritz Lang in his movie, but in the face of a decay. The world consists of two blocks, which are properly labeled in a book, which are in a continuous war between each other. And the story is about a particular individual, Winston Smith, who is living in one of it, which is the England, is that part of the world to which British islands belong. And that is the world which is where this utopian, this dystopian history is brought to almost to the very end. There is nothing, it's a society which is totally under the power of a big brother. And this big brother has remember, this is 40s, 48, 49. Who has the rest of the society under the complete surveillance. Today's discussion about the surveillance by the tools like Pegasus if you have read the Orwell, then you are not surprised by having a story about the Pegasus, for example. And the big brother is continuously watching you. So this today, a cliche word, big brother is watching you, about this big telecommunication system and so forth, is actually taken from a George Orwell book. This is also the society where there is a minister of a truth, which is basically ministry which rewrites the history. It continuously publish the newspapers, because if there is a one of the members of the ruling clique, I mean, a mafia, because it's hardly possible to call it political party, which runs the Britain, then when one of the members of it is, for this reason or another, falling out of the grace with the big brother, then he disappears from history. So Winston is actually working in the ministry by replacing the existence of a given person in a previous historical box. That was done in the Soviet Russia. There are these famous pictures of the Russian Politburo with him from the Stalin time, in which they keep the faces and those individuals who fall out of the grace with Stalin were retouched, removed from the picture, and were not existing anymore. That was rewriting a previous past history in order to make it acceptable to the current situation. So this is the Ministry of Truth. There is also ministry which invents a new language. There is a new speed, there is a special language which is being used there, which is not there, which uses the English words and English grammar, but it's a very special kind of language, which is called the newspeak. And that is always in this dystopian character. And the book was called 1984. And before I show you a trailer of a movie based on it, which will allow you to get a glimpse of that book also, I mean, tell you that the reason why Orwell had written it was that he was also in the 30s correspondent in Soviet Union, and he witnessed there these political trials of the 30s. And so the book is draws on his knowledge about the totalitarian systems, German and Russian, and that in Spain, and mix it up with the danger of atomic war. In the 70s, there was a political movement in the, at that time, Soviet Union, which goes under the name Refuzni. There were individuals and many scientists who had refused to collaborate with the existing totalitarian system. And one of them was Andrei Amalric. He was a historian. And in the 70s, he had written the book, which appears in Soviet Union in the underground printing form, which there was a whole industry of illegally printing books called Sam Is That. We print the books by ourselves. And this title of the Amalric book is called Will the Soviet Union Survive Until 1984? And the title of Amalric book is clearly taken from Orwell. And as we know, Amalric prediction was, prophecy was just off by 16 years, but was basically a truth. All right, so this is a trailer. Let's hope it will be played. This is the from the film of the 1984, and the rule of the one of these totalitarian leaders in that movie was the last movie, actually one, the last performance of one of the greatest British authors of a 20th actors of a 20th century, Richard Burton. We will see him in a moment. And the Winston was played by this individual whom you know, for example, from the movie Alien. Let's see whether we will be. Oh, yes.
In 1948, this man had a vision, a haunting and terrifying vision of what the world might become before the end of the 20th century. He imagined the world held in a grip of fear, a world of absolute conformity, of continuous surveillance, of organized hatred, and ceaseless war. A world where pleasure is forbidden, where language and history are being systematically destroyed, and where living people simply vanish. The visionary was George Orwell. He turned his nightmare into the biggest selling futuristic novel of our time. Now, with perfect timing, his achievement becomes a unique motion picture event with a cast to match its stature. John Hurt is Winston Smith, solitary rebel against a merciless state, a classic hero in spite of himself.
There is truth, and there is untruth. Even if I am alone.
Richard Burton, in his last screen role, is O'Brien, privileged and powerful, ambiguous, lethal.
If you want a vision of the future, Winston, imagine a boot stamping on a human face forever.
Susanna Hamilton is Julia, whose love for Winston transforms his secret dreams into vivid, dangerous reality.
They can't get inside you. They can't get to your heart.
Please don't like us much.
And Cyril Cusack is Charrington, inhabiting a furtive world where nothing is what it seems.
Tell me, Winston, what are your true feelings towards Big Brother?
I hate him.
You must love him. It's not enough to obey him. You must love him. You asked me once what was in Rome 101. Everyone knows. The thing that is in Rome 101. The worst thing in the world.
John Hurt, Richard Burton, Susanna Hamilton, Cyril Cusack. Michael Radford's film of George Orwell's 1984. The film of the book of the year.
All right, so that gives you a certain glimpse on what the book, and if you will be it's translated, the book was translated, I believe, in most of the languages. And so there is no problem with reading it in your own language. But I believe it's one of those books which an educated individual should read. And not only read, but also deeply thought about the what is the message through the book for our own thinking? We have to think about what is in the book, and somehow it's one of these extra time books. It's valid in every period of time of a history of the mankind since it was written. And the outcome of a second war was a tremendous period of time for science, and particularly for dissemination of a science in the everyday life. The incredible amount of scientific and technological discoveries which were made during the second war had been there, and the companies which invented those technologies and developed those technologies, for example, during the war, they had to do something with it. In the and there was a flow of the technological and scientific discovery in everyday life. But it was, for example, the German companies, which had been making a lot of technological progress during the war, they were not allowed to produce weapons anymore. And they were forced by the, at least in the west part of the Germany, the newly established government to rebuild the industry of the country and the life of this destroyed country by manufacturing things which were needed for everyday life. So for example, this is just one of example, a company, Miele, which is famous company making a making many, I mean, ovens, kitchens and so forth. It's also manufacturing, was during the war manufacturing the engines for the torpedoes. And that was the trick which used to build up a contemporary side-loaded washers, which we have in our homes. I mean, the automatic washers built up in the United States are top-loading. So the drums which rotates are horizontally located, not vertically located. And the suspension of these drums is the what follow from the Miele, that is why the Miele company is one of the best companies making house utensils. There were companies which manufacture radars during the war. And there were lots of not used old-fashioned radars at the time. And that was used by the, that was the beginning of a radio astronomy. The Bernard Lovell, a professor of astronomy in Manchester, got with his students an amount of, essentially arbitrary amount of electronic at the time, junk of a British army, which was somewhere rotting in some storage, and built up this first giant radio telescope in Jodelbein. The company Raytheon, which was used building, manufacturing many microwave devices for radars during the war, and which is now, the Raytheon nowadays is one of the major weapon producers in the world. It makes the Patriot missiles and Aegis missiles and so forth. Raytheon used the knowledge of a technology, of a microwave technology, to build up a first microwave oven. And but I mean, even the society which feared the atomic bombs, the word atomic and nuclear was not negative at the time. Whatever was super duper was called atomic. There was a company making skis, and those skis are atomics, and they are called atomic until today. When the new fashion of swimming suits for ladies was invented, it was called bikini. The reason was because a bikini island in the Pacific was famous for the first hydrogen bomb explosion. Television, which was already known in the 20s, becomes all over the sudden a competition to the radio. And in a period of few years, the radio set, which was the main item in a household around which the life of the house of the families was circling, so to say. The radio set was replaced by the television set. The black and white television sets becomes relatively cheap. And very soon a color television set been brought to the market. So in spite of this, there was incredible acceleration of the medical science. The X-ray machines were so easy to get, and the technology of making the X-ray medical machines was so developed that the computerized tomography was invented, and so forth and so forth and so forth. But nevertheless, people fear that there is this danger of the end of the civilization. So this dystopian view from the time of a metropolis, that much it shows up one in the book by Orwell, but it also was in the different kinds of literature. The one of the literature which exploded in the 40s, 50s, 60s was what we nowadays call the science fiction. There were many, many science fiction authors writing the books, and one of the most famous of the writers of a scientific books, actually not only science books, was American writer Ray Bradbury, who lived between 1920 and 2012. And one of his books, which was the most important, is again a dystopian view of a future civilization. And the title of that book is Fahrenheit 451. That number, 451, is a temperature in the Fahrenheit units at which the paper burned. And that is the history, a story of a future civilization where the books are banned. The books are not allowed. And there are special fire brigades which are not extinguishing fire, but they are teams which, when the police, a special political kind of a police, which discover that there is an underground storage of books somewhere, sends those units to burn the books, and that the paper burns at the 451. So that's the title of that book. And this is as in the 1984, there was this character Winston who starts to be opposing the system. In the Fahrenheit 451, it's one of those firemen who burned the books, which changed the sides and become a defender of all our knowledge and past, which is stored in the books. There were many different versions of that book, which was there were many films, movies, which are based on that book by Ray Bradbury, which have been done in period of years. There was even one done in Poland. And this is a trailer which I found of one of those films which again will give you a feeling about what that, what was the book about.
Have you ever seen a physical book before?
Do you want to know what's inside? Insanity. Chaos.
By the time you guys grow up, there won't be one book left.
Little knowledge is a dangerous thing.
News, facts, memoirs, internetable, burdens.
You're not born equal, so you must be made equal by the fire.
I want to burn.
Bradbury had written many different books, and one of his less dramatic books is the Martian history about the civilization built up on the Mars. And he was a master of short stories. One of those short stories is a short novel called A Beautiful Morning. And this is a story where there is a day comes, and it's a morning in the house of the future. It's a beautiful villa next to the ocean with the fantastic views. And it wakes up, and the robots prepare the breakfast, and the other robots clean it and something, and nobody eats that breakfast. So the breakfast goes on into the machines which dispose it properly, and then the same thing happens during a lunch. And the same thing happened during the evening. And then the nights came. And there is another beautiful day. And there are no humans around. And after many weeks of the absence of the humans, a heavy wind comes. And one of the trees fall and destroys a window and destroys one of the computers in that house, and everything eventually disappears, and the civilization is gone. And that was a book which was written, that was a novel or a short story written after the another element of fear had been brought to the general society. That was when the story about the so-called neutron bomb became fashionable. Neutron bomb was a kind of a nuclear weapon which caused a relatively minor explosion, but generated a tremendous amount of the high energy neutrons. It was a nuclear explosion which was not so much energetically, but it produces lots of neutrons. And neutrons killed all the living organisms. And it was supposed to be the weapon used for better than the nuclear weapon, because a few days after this explosion of a neutron bomb, our army could have entered the place without any danger, because the neutrons are gone after a few minutes. So there was lots of these things. But one of the most important science fiction writers of the 20th century was a Polish writer, Stanisław Lem. And I will be talking for a moment about the Stanisław Lem. This is a picture of a Stanisław Lem. And I just mentioned few of the publications. The Lem was born in Lviv, which is a town now in Ukraine. And he started his medical training before the Second War as a medical doctor. That was interrupted by the Second War. After the war, he finished the medical school at the University of Krakow, but he didn't continue his medical profession, and he became a fully-fledged author. First writing for a journal, a weekly journal in Krakow called Tygodnik Powszechny, which was the only, which had in the 50s was the only, and until 89 was basically the only non-communist sponsored weekly which was permitted to be printed in Poland. It was heavily censored, but nevertheless it was a little area of a freedom of for the writers and intellectuals. And Lem was a young contributor to that Tygodnik Powszechny at the beginning, but very quickly he had changed his activity to writing a science fiction story. But there are several, but his first book, a really first book, is called The Hospital of Transfiguration. We will be talking about it in a moment. That is a book of his experience as a medical doctor, but transfigurated to the time of a war. I will tell you in a moment what was the book. His first really book of a science fiction was a book called Astronauts. And that is a story about the first human expedition to the planet of Venus. And I picked up on the relatively at random some books. The one is the Magellanic Cloud, about the intergalaxy travels. And there is a collection of a short stories called The Cosmic Diary. There is another, one of the most important scientific book, science fiction books in the 20th century called Solaris. And there are many other, like a book like His Master Voice, The Tale of a Pilot, I'm sorry, there's a little eye here, The Pilot Perks. It's a collection of a short stories with one hero, a cosmic pilot, Mr. Perks. And they are cast as a story of a sailors, of a 18th and 19th century sailors discovering lives and so on. There is another book which is very important. I have made a mistake. It should be read. It's called The Memories Found in the Bathtub. In some sense, it's the Ray Bradbury Fahrenheit 451, but told differently. It's another dystopian story. There is a civilization where a certain paper disease developed. There is a, now I'm not sure I should just say that this is a bacteria or a virus. Anyway, something which destroys all the paper existing on the world. So it's like a Fahrenheit Brigade, which have to destroy the books. So the books are gone, everything is gone. And in one of the old houses, there is a abandoned bathtub, which was somehow overturned, and the little manuscript containing the memories of some individual are found. This little paper, this little volume had survived this disease of paper, so to say, and that's just this memory, that are these memories found in the bathtub. And Lem was also writing books and stories which have not been science fiction. He was a thinker, thinking about the expansion of science and technology in the future. And in the 70s, he had written a book which is called The Summa Technology. That is, of course, a title which is a transgression, transfiguration of the St. Thomas book, Summa Theology. And this is a collection of stories about the science and so forth. Lem was extremely well educated, and he really knew a lot of about physics and mathematics. So this is an interesting book. He also wrote the criminal story, which is a criminal story, which is also science fiction. It's called The Chain of Chance. And in English, in Polish, it's Katar, the sneezing. And that is just a small collection of titles from his. He was extremely, he wrote a lot of things. And I picked up these two books, The Hospital of Transfiguration, for this was one of his books before he was a science fiction author, and Solaris. And this is The Hospital of Transfiguration. It was written in 1948, but it was not published, printed before 1975. So it was existing in a few copies, but the book had appeared in 1975. And very soon a movie was made. The story is, there is a small village on the countryside where the mental asylum is placed. And the hero who is Stanisław Lem is a young medical doctor which gets there as his first job. And there are lots of doctors in that hospital who had, well, they live in some kind of a close community with those patients. And the doctors have the lengthy discussion about the humans, problems of humanity. And some of those patients who are, there's one of them is a very famous writer who gets sick. And there are others who say, who found the shelter there because they fear of the war, which is already going on. And then the German army came into that village and the patients are executed. And It's an incredibly tough book. And that was a movie made on it. And again, there's a trailer which will let you have a glimpse of the book.
Wydawało mi się, że medycyna jest tą dziedziną wiedzy,
która jest najbliższa człowieka. And I apologize that it's in Polish.
Sprzedam panu mój mózg. Często pan tak
zapomina. I sell you my brain.
Nie pamiętam. Niczego tu nie zmienisz. Panie doktorze, boję się. Proszę mnie przyjmować.
Apokaliptyczne wizje zagłady szpitala psychiatrycznego jako parabolę ludzkiego losu w czasach ludobójstwa. Szpital przemienienia.
All right, so that was that book. And the other book is Solaris. And Solaris is, as I said, one of the most incredible books of the 20th science fiction books in the 20th century. The one of the issues by the science fiction authors is how the contacts of the humans will look like if we humans contact the other civilization. And in most of those books, this other civilization is more or less anthropogenic. It looks like us. It is like we are living. And there are very few authors who were able to dare to attempt to invent the other civilization, which will be completely different than the humans, the other life, so to say, which doesn't look like a little green man or little animals or whatever. And the book of Lem Solaris is a story about the planet somewhere in the far from the Earth, which has been discovered that it is covered by it's completely covered with the ocean. But that ocean turns out not to be a water. It's a living organ. There's no way to communicate with that organ in a simple way. So the expedition is sent and the special satellite circled that planet. And there are scientists there who attempt to communicate or understand what is the structure of that living organism. And at the one stage, the communication with that station flying, the satellite is broken. So there is a investigating scientist, a psychologist with the name Calvin, who is being sent there to that planet, to that satellite, to see what had happened. And he found there that in some sense a communication was established, that there are certain dramatic events on that satellite which do happen. And what happens is that the people who are on the station, the scientists, they have their memories and they have various things in our memories. There are nice things from our past and possibly ugly moments of our life. But there are places about which we do not want to think continuously at present time. And the communication was established because all of a sudden, and events from our past had been physically recreated on that satellite. The things do happen. And for example, this incoming pilot, psychologist, Mr. Calvin, lost his wife years before. And all of a sudden, this woman is recreated on the, physically recreated. And the story is what's going on, what happens. There were at least two film productions based on that book. The one was a production by a Russian, very famous Russian director, Targosky, Andrei Targosky, and I did not have the trailer of it. And the other one, most modern, was, I forgot the director name, but the main character is played by a very famous actor, Clooney. So this is a trailer of that movie.
When you want to get hitched, you keep putting this off. 15 or 20 years, I'm just going to stop asking. You're with the right man. Your wife.
She's dead.
Hello.
not your wife. You're dreaming her. She's alive.
You found me.
I came for you. This is my chance.
You don't know what you're in for. Go back. Go back to her. You'll die here.
You're being manipulated.
We are not taking her with us.
Are you going to stop me from taking her back?
That was the Solaris book, and it's also translated in many languages, so you can see. I would like to show you the another science fiction writer of the 20th century, Isaac Asimov. Asimov was actually a scientist by himself. He was a professor of biochemistry on one of the universities in New York City and Boston. And he was prolific. He had written hundreds of stories. And I just would like to focus attention on a particular chain of books, which are again in addressing the issue, what happens to the civilization. And what Asimov had did, he moved the story billions of years back. And we have the civilization which destroys itself and recreates itself millennia before the solar system came to existence. And the first of this book is called The Foundations. I'm not going to tell you what is the story because it will take too long, but it is a movie which you can now see in one of the streaming channels. There was a serial made on that book pretty recently, so it's possible to watch it. And the continuation of that is another series of book. The Foundation is several books. The Galactic Empire is 15, if I remember. It's called Galactic Empire. And the final book, which somehow tries to establish a connection between the story of the, in a quotation, ancient civilization, but not ancient in the sense of archaeologists are talking about it recently, nowadays. It's the book called The Robots of Dawn, about the robots. And the title of the book is Robots. And all of us are using the word robots nowadays permanently. I use the word robots talking about the one of the short stories of Ray Bradbury just a few minutes ago. So from where that word robots came from, and that came from a book, a theater play written by Czech writer Karel Čapek. And that's a picture of Karel Čapek, who was one of the most important writers of the period of time just before the Second War. These are the titles of his few books. One of these books is called, they were all about the dystopian characters of a dystopian pictures of our civilization. but they were predominantly addressing social issues. And one of them is a factor of absolute. The other one is the war with newts. Newts is a kind of a reptile. And the third is the Book of Apocrypha. This is the remarkable book. In Polish, it's called The Invasion of Reptiles, but the English title is War with the Newts. This is a story that on a remote island on the Pacific island, an island on the Pacific Ocean, the exhibition discovers a kind of newts, reptiles, which are very nice and very intelligent. They learn very quickly what they are told to do, and they are very skillful in using their four legs and hands, in using them actually like we use our hands. And it very quickly found out that these reptiles can be taught to do initially a very manual work of humans. So they are very clean and very kind, so they can be used as a home servants, and they can be trained to become workers in a factory. And slowly they learn more and more and more. They can operate the complicated factories and so forth. And at the one stage of a game, some government figures out that they can train these reptiles to be soldiers. And they become formidable soldiers. And that's the end of the civilization. Those reptiles very quickly become a dominant over the humans. The addition point is that those reptiles, there's a problem with the water. Those reptiles don't drink water. But that's a minor point. And eventually those reptiles destroy the human civilization and they take over the globe. There's this other civilization, and the humans, of course, have a war with them and so forth and so on. So the Čapek had wanted to show the problem of allowing the civilization which does not share the same virtues as our civilization, at least pretend to be based on, to be competing with our civilization, because eventually those civilization which does not follow our virtues will win. Čapek was also writing a lot of political stories. He was a journalist, a publicist, in writing in the many, not only Czech journals. So he became an enemy of the German fascism. And as you see, he died in 1938. This was just before the annexation of Czechoslovakia, which at the time existed as Czechoslovakia, by the Third Reich. So he had left Prague and moved to his summer cottage, hoping that when the Germans will occupy the Czechoslovakia, they will not find him so easily there. But he had to fix the roof of his house, and he fell down from that roof, got very sick, and he died in 1938 when the Czechoslovakia was occupied by the Germans, they remarkable, they didn't knew that he's dead. And they were looking for him. They arrested his family living in Prague and so forth. But that was the story of Karl Čapek. But what we will be discussing next week is the most important contribution to Čapek to our history. This is a theater play called R.U.R., Rozum's Universal Robots. This is the first time in 1921 where the word robot was invented. It was invented by Karl Čapek. And it immediately became extremely fashionable. As I said, it's a theater play. It's for some reasons, I believe I know why, and we will be talking about it next week. It's not so often played nowadays, but as far as I know, it was only once after the Second War played in Poland. It was in Warsaw in the Kammer, in this, on the second stage of the Polish theater in Warsaw. And as a very young student, I had a chance of seeing it. And I tell you the story about it. And why that is important in the next week, but perhaps I will jump forward to tell you that Isaac Asimov had written a book in the 50s with the name Robot. And this book of Isaac Asimov contains the three laws of robotics, which are considered to be the still the laws which the manufacturing of robots should obey. And there are three laws. A robot may not injure a human being or through inaction allow human being to come to a harm. A robot must obey the orders given it by human beings except where such orders would conflict with the first law. So we cannot order a robot to kill a human. And the third, a robot must protect his own existence as long as such a protection does not conflict with the first or second law. The main issue is that the robot should not injure or harm a human being. Why all of a sudden that was so important for Asimov in the 90s? And this is because of the content of the play R.U.R. And we will discuss it next week. So thanks a lot. Let me stop sharing the screen. And we will see each other next week, the same time. And we start with discussing the play R.U.R. And this is a remarkable piece of literature. And it's really a pity that it is not being popular on the stages nowadays, and it's being mutilated in the concept of it in many, many movies and books written after the original story of Čapek. So thanks for being with me today, and we see each other next week. Bye-bye.